Very good morning to all of you. Today we'll continue the vulval cancer. As you know, vulval cancer is the fourth commonest female gynecological cancer. And nowadays the incidence is increasing in the young population due to STIs, sexually transmitted infections, but it is usually common in postmenopausal women. So now there is increased incidence of young patients, and so detailed history and investigation to be done for diagnosis and for proper management, it should be all the investigations, detailed investigations to be done. We have already discussed all this, and we'll start the management proper. Before management, the staging should be done. The staging, there are two types of staging: TNM staging, tumor node metastasis staging, and FIGO staging. So FIGO staging again modified in 2009, and this depends upon the clinical findings, and it depends upon the size of the local lesion, size, site, and groin node involvement and metastasis mainly. There are so many other factors also there, and each case is to be individualized. So first is TNM staging system. So T0, pre-malignant change, and T1, a cancer less than 2 cm in diameter in size and less than 1 mm in depth of invasion, And T1B means a cancer less than 2 cm in diameter but more than 1 mm in depth of invasion. Then T2, greater than 2 cm in diameter, the size of the tumor. Then T3, when it involves vagina, urethra, or anus. Then T4, when it involves bladder, rectum, and pelvic bone. Then N0, no lymph node involved. N for lymph node. So N0, no lymph node involved. And N1, lymph node metastasis to one groin, ipsilateral, the same side usually. And N2, lymph node metastasis to both groins, bilateral lymph node involvement, then metastasis. M0 or M1. M0 indicates no distant metastasis, and M1 means any distant metastasis present. So according to the TNM classification, the primary tumor classified as TX when the primary tumor cannot be assessed, and T0 when there is no evidence of primary tumor. TX, the primary tumor cannot be assessed, but T0 means there is no primary tumor. Then TIS, carcinoma in situ, that is pre-invasive carcinoma. And T1, tumor confined to the vulva and or perineum 2 cm or less in greatest dimension. T1. Then T2, tumor confined to the vulva and or perineum more than 2 cm in greatest dimension. T1 is less than 2 cm, 2 cm less, but T2 is more than 2 cm. Then T3, when tumor involves any of the following lower urethra, vagina or anus. Then T4, tumor involves any of the following bladder mucosa or rectal mucosa or upper urethra or pelvic bone. Then node, regional lymph nodes. So regional lymph nodes are the femoral and inguinal nodes, and NX means regional lymph nodes cannot be accessed. Then N0, no lymph node metastasis, and N1, unilateral regional lymph node metastasis or ipsilateral lymph node metastasis, usually same side metastasis, and N2 is bilateral regional lymph node metastasis, ipsilateral and also contralateral regional lymph node involvement was there. Then according to distant metastasis, MX, presence of distant metastasis which cannot be assessed. Then M0, no distant metastasis seen, and M1, distant metastasis that is present, pelvic lymph node metastasis is M1. Then according to the FIGO staging of carcinoma of the vulva, which is modified in 2009, International Federation of Obstetrics and Gynecology modified the staging of the carcinoma of the vulva, that is modified FIGO staging of 2009, and it depends upon the clinical findings, and it is applied to the primary carcinoma excluding the melanoma. Then there are 4 stages: stage 1, stage 2, stage 3 and stage 4. And stage 1, tumor confined to the vulva, tumor confined to the vulva. Then again stage 1A or stage 1B. In stage 1A, when the tumor or lesion equal or less than 2 cm in size, confined to the vulva or perineum, and with a stromal invasion that is equal or less than 1 mm. That is, stromal invasion is also important. And there is no nodal metastasis. Here the stromal invasion is less than 1 mm and the tumor size is equal or less than 2 cm. Then stage 1B, when the lesion is more than 2 cm in size or with stromal invasion more than 1 mm, confined to the vulvar perineum with negative nodes. In stage 1, there is lymph nodes are negative. Then stage 2, here tumor of any size with extension to adjacent perineal structures like lower 1/3 of urethra or lower 1/3 of vagina, anus, here also there is negative lymph nodes. Here there is extension of the lesion or tumor to the lower 1/3 of urethra or lower 1/3 of vagina or anus. But here also the lymph nodes are negative. Then in stage 3, here the tumor of any size with or without extension to adjacent perineal structures, that is stage 2, stress structure 1/3, lower 1/3 of urethra or lower 1/3 of vagina or anus with positive inguinal femoral lymph nodes. Here stage 3 means stage 2 plus positive inguinal femoral lymph nodes. Femoral lymph nodes are positive along with stage 2. So stage 3 means stage 2 plus positive lymph nodes. Then again stage 3A, B, C. Stage 3A, again according to the number of node involved. It is subdivided into stage 1BC and again stage 1A. With one lymph node metastasis equal or more than 5 millimeter, or 1 to 2 lymph nodes metastasis less than 5 millimeter. This is stage 3A. Then stage 3B, when with 2 or more lymph node metastasis, 2 or more lymph node metastasis more than equal 5 millimeter, or 3 or more lymph node metastasis less than 5 millimeter. Then stage 3 with positive nodes with extra capsule spread, means there is lesion has spread along the capsule of the lymph node, and more than 50% of the lymph node are replaced by the cancer cells, so the lymph nodes are more involved in this stage 3C. Then stage 4, tumor invades other regional structures like upper two-thirds of urethra and or upper two-thirds of vagina or distant structures. Then it may be stage 4A and 4B. Here in stage 4, the upper two-thirds of urethra and vagina are involved, or distant structures are also involved. So again, it is subdivided into stage 4A and stage 4B. Then in case of stage 4A, tumor invades any of the following, like stage 4A1, upper urethral and or vaginal mucosa. Along with that, there is involvement of bladder mucosa, rectal mucosa, or fixed to pelvic bone. This is stage 4A1. In stage 4, upper two-thirds of urethra or upper two-thirds of vagina is involved. Along with that, stage 4A1, the bladder mucosa, rectal mucosa, or fixed to pelvic bone. Then stage 4A2, when the lesion is the lymph node involved are fixed or ulcerated inguinofemoral lymph nodes. Then stage 4B, any distant metastasis including pelvic lymph nodes. When there is presence of distant metastasis, then it is the stage 4B, it is the most advanced stage of the disease. Stage 4B, stage 3 and 4 are advanced stage of the disease. So next is management. So how to manage? So management is either prophylactic or treatment proper. So first is prophylactic measures should be taken, like adequate therapy for non-neoplastic epithelial disorders of the vulva, which are the precancers. That is why adequate therapy should be taken for non-neoplastic epithelial disorders of vulva, like lichen sclerosis and other vulval skin lesions. Then adequate therapy for persistent pruritus vulvi in postmenopausal women. So when there is symptom of pruritus vulvi, in especially in case of postmenopausal women, adequate and proper treatment should be given. Then frequent use of multiple biopsies in conservative treatment of VIN, vulval intraepithelial neoplasia. From different sites, multiple biopsies should be taken. Then liberal use of simple vulvectomy in postmenopausal women with VIN, where follow-up facilities are not available, because though there is in VIN, simple vulvectomy is not ideal, but when there is follow-up facilities are not available, the patient will not come for regular follow-up, then simple vulvectomy is the ideal treatment in case of postmenopausal women when follow-up is not available. Then intraepithelial lesions are treated a number of different ways. It depends upon the site, the age of the patient, and the size of the lesion, and it is proper to excise with a 3 to 4 millimeter margin and then primarily close the area. So intraepithelial lesion should be treated properly with excision of wide margin so that there will be recurrence will be less. Then it should be diagnosed properly by wedge biopsy or external biopsies or colposcopy. And it's very important to remember that you have to examine the remainder of the genital tract, because other parts, the malignancy may be present to other genital organs like vagina or cervix. So detailed examination should be done. Then proper treatment. Surgery is the most important one, and it is the cornerstone of treatment, and this is the main method of treatment. Though other methods of treatment are chemotherapy, radiotherapy, or immunotherapy, or combined. So surgery is the most important method of treatment of cancer vulva, and majority of FIGO stage 1 and 2 will be cured by surgery only. Only surgery can cure the stage 1 and stage 2 cases completely. There is no need of chemotherapy or radiotherapy in stage 1 and stage 2. And because of most vulval cancer present at an advanced stage in developing countries, and also in case of postmenopausal patients, the other modalities like chemotherapy and radiotherapy may have to be used. Sometimes it has also a role, but in stage 1 and 2, there is usually surgery is the main treatment. It can cure the disease. Then what is the standard surgical treatment? The pioneer is Halsted. Halsted is the pioneer in case of radical vulvectomy. Usually the treatment of choice in cancer vulva is radical vulvectomy with bilateral inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy, which was devised by Halsted in 1931. So he was the pioneer about the radical vulvectomy with bilateral inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy and selective pelvic lymphadenectomies. Previously, Halsted done radical vulvectomy with bilateral inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy in one incision, usually by a butterfly incision. But nowadays, it is radical vulvectomy and bilateral inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy is being done through 3 separate incisions. One for radical vulvectomy and 2 for each on groin for lymph node dissection. So nowadays there are 3 separate incisions are given. Previously it was done by Halsted through one incision, very long incision, and the operation was mutilating and very mortality and morbidity was high, so it was modified nowadays. So you see there are 2 pictures. The lower picture shows the Halsted method of incision, where butterfly-like incision was given previously. So there is a long excision of the skin was done, but nowadays the upper diagram shows there are 3 separate incisions, one on radical vulvectomy and 2 other incisions, groin incisions were there, one on each side for lymph node dissection. So it is less mutilating. It got here the it is in this operation was very extensive. Previously Halsted, according to Halsted, but nowadays the incision, instead of one incision, there are three incisions through which radical vulvectomy and bilateral inguinofemoral lymphectomy is being done nowadays, which has equal success rate and but the and complications are less in case of three incisions. So this picture shows the vulvectomy operation, cancer vulva. Here also local excision is being done. Sometimes we'll have to depend upon the age of the patient. Nowadays younger patients are coming, so we'll have to think about their age and the future. So local excision is now being also done instead of radical vulvectomy. So standard surgery is standard en bloc radical vulvectomy and bilateral groin node dissection as described by the Tosic and Way. So this was associated with high incidence of morbidity, wound infection, necrosis and tissue breakdown and pulmonary embolism and lymphedema and more bleeding, hemorrhage, and there is also problems with the body image and sexual function. So now the recent trend is not to cure patient but to preserve body image and sexual function by performing less radical surgery. Now there is trend towards the conservative radical surgery or less radical surgery, because now there is the aim is to preserve the body image and the sexual function. And because there are more cases of young patients are coming with vulval cancer, so individualization of the treatment should be done depending upon the size and position of the tumor or site of the tumor and depth of stromal invasion and age and performance status of the patient, this and also lymph node involvement. So previously there was extensive surgery, Halsted done extensive surgery previously to start with. That was the treatment of choice, radical vulvectomy with bilateral lymphadenectomy through one incision, butterfly incision by Halsted. But nowadays this treatment is modified. So what are the factors led to modification of standard treatment of cancer vulva? Number one, the disease is occurring in younger women more commonly nowadays. The incidence of younger women are increasing and they are also presenting with smaller tumors. Previously the tumors were very large size because they were diagnosed at late stage and patients were coming in the late stage with the bigger tumors, larger tumors. But nowadays the younger women are more instead of the postmenopausal women, and the tumors are small instead of large tumors. Then concern about the postoperative morbidity and associated with long term hospitalization after en bloc radical dissection. So the previous operation, mutilating surgery, extensive surgery, which has more morbidity and mortality. So to reduce that, it should be the less radical surgery is thought of, and also to decrease the hospitalization. Then increasing awareness of the psychosexual consequences of radical vulvectomy. Previously, the cancer vulva means radical vulvectomy. Means, so there is complete removal of the vulva, disfigurement of the organ. So the psychosexual consequence is bad. So nowadays there is increased awareness of the psychosexual consequences. So this is the modification of the standard treatment of radical vulvectomy with bilateral inguinofemoral lymphectomy is done. The modification is done. There is a tendency towards the less radical surgery. So early vulval cancer T1N01. In that case, factors to consider in determining the appropriate treatment are that is the primary lesion and the involvement of the groin lymph nodes. And accordingly, the management of primary lesion is done either by radical vulvectomy or radical local excision. That is also sufficient according to the individual patient. Less radical local excision is less radical vulvectomy than the complete radical vulvectomy. So management of groin lymph nodes, that is also most important in the management of the cancer vulva. So with stromal invasion equal or less than 1 millimeter, there is usually no risk of lymph node metastasis. So groin dissection is not required. It should be omitted. Why unnecessary? If there is lymph node metastasis is not there, that should not be removed. Then with stromal invasion of more than 1 millimeter, the inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy is required because there is chance of lymph node, inguinofemoral lymph nodes are involved when there is stromal invasion of more than 1 millimeter, then there is more chance of involvement of the inguinofemoral lymph nodes. Then management of T2, early T3 tumors and node 1 to 2. Then radical vulvectomy with bilateral inguinofemoral lymphectomy is the ideal choice and proper treatment. And sometimes thinking about the age of the patient, partial resection of the organ is done, but the follow-up should be done and with wider margin, free margin should be excised. If partial resection of the organ is done, then the basic surgical approaches are en bloc approach through trapezoid or butterfly incision. We have seen the incision, butterfly incision, which was a fast incision by Stoll. That was given butterfly incision, but now there are 3 separate incisions are given. Then if there is one microscopically positive groin node, there is no further therapy is required, but follow-up is a must. But when 2 or more positive nodes are involved, then post-operative groin irradiation will suffice the disease. Then in case of advanced disease, stage 3 and stage 4, then it depends upon again whether what is the general condition of the patient, whether it is operable or not, and whether any comorbid condition is associated or any other disease or malignancy is associated. So in case of advanced disease, large T3 or T4 primary tumor or the presence of bulky positive groin nodes, then this should be individualized. The case, different factors we have told, then ideally the advanced cases should have pelvic exenteration combined with radical vulvectomy and bilateral groin dissection. But again, this is extensive surgery, pelvic exenteration with more or high morbidity and mortality. So it can be also modified. So in that case, so first radiation therapy, radiotherapy is given. Then after that, surgical operation is done, radical vulvectomy. Or if it is operable, then radical vulvectomy is done followed by the lymph node groin irradiation should be done postoperatively. And if the patient's condition is not fit for major surgery in advanced stage, then the cases can be done in two stages, two different days. So first, total vulvectomy is done, and in other days, lateral days, the lymphectomy, bilateral lymphectomy can be done. Two stages or two separate days, it can be done. Or first, chemotherapy is given, or radiotherapy is given. Then after that, after 5 weeks, then surgery, radical vulvectomy can be done. So depending upon the condition of the patient, general condition of the patient, and also associated comorbid conditions, and also whether operable or not. So there may be also chemo radiation as primary therapy. It can be given in advanced stages when there is advanced stage and not suitable for operation. So chemo radiation is given first. Then after 5 weeks, usually radical surgery, radical vulvectomy with bilateral groin dissection is done. Then in some cases also preoperative radiation with or without concurrent chemotherapy is given. Preoperative radiation given. Then preoperative radiation with or without chemotherapy, then surgery. So accordingly, the cases have to be individualized. So what is the current approach to patients with N2 or N3 groin lymph nodes? A pre-op CT or ultrasonography of pelvis to determine whether there are enlarged pelvic lymph nodes. And enlarged groin lymph nodes are removed through a separate incision approach. You have seen these two, one incision each on each groin, and separate approach should be taken and sent for a frozen section biopsy or diagnosis whenever available. Then that is ideal. If by frozen section diagnosis or biopsy confirms, if metastatic disease is confirmed, full lymphadenectomy is not performed because it is again extensive surgery with high morbidity and mortality. And any enlarged pelvic nodes seen on CT or sonar ultrasound are removed via an extraperitoneal approach that can be removed extraperitoneally. Then full pelvic and groin irradiation. So instead of removing the lymph nodes, then irradiation can be given. Then if frozen section reveals no metastatic disease, lymph nodes, full groin dissection is performed to remove the lymph nodes. Then complications for surgery, early complications and late complications. Usually radical vulvectomy with bilateral lymphadenectomy is a very, very major surgery and extensive surgery with many complications. And it should be done with expert surgeons and with all facilities available. So it is very, very major surgery. So there are many complications in this radical vulvectomy with bilateral lymphadenectomy. So early complications like they may occur groin wound infection, necrosis and breakdown, and major immediate morbidity. Then there may be urinary infection, seroma in femoral triangle while during the removal of the lymph node, and deep venous thrombosis as there is very extensive surgery, and hemorrhage, and there can be also pulmonary embolism and myocardial infection, and there is more hemorrhage and osteitis pubis. And naturally there are also complications of anesthesia, and there may be anesthesia of the anterior thigh from femoral nerve injury. There is risk of injury to the femoral nerve, so there is anesthesia or numbness of the anterior thigh. Then late complications are chronic leg edema, which is the major late complication, and there may be recurrent lymphangitis, cellulitis of legs, and stress urinary incontinence with or without genital prolapse and intertidal stenosis, and there may be femoral hernia and pelvic osteomyelitis, and there may be also fistulas like rectovaginal or rectoperineal perineal. Then radiotherapy is also having a role in the management of the cancer vulva, because there is also advancement in the radiotherapy. Intensity modulated radiotherapy is now coming up, so it can also beneficial for the treatment of cancer vulva. So it can be used preoperatively or along with the other methods, chemotherapy, and it can be also postoperatively. So preoperatively, in patients with advanced disease who would require pelvic eccentration, so pelvic, you can avoid pelvic eccentration by giving radiotherapy preoperatively, because pelvic eccentration is very extensive surgery with high morbidity and mortality. So to avoid pelvic eccentration, preoperatively radiotherapy can be given, and it can be also given postoperatively to treat the pelvic lymph nodes and groin lymph nodes with two or more positive groin nodes. Usually the treatment of a choice is bilateral lymphadenectomy or removal of the all lymph nodes, inguinal and pelvic lymph nodes, when it is positive. But it is also again very extensive and difficult surgery, and to avoid this, the postoperatively radiotherapy can be given instead of doing this extensive and difficult bilateral lymphadenectomy. So it is also helpful postoperatively. So you can also, the lymphadenectomy can also be avoided. Then what are other roles for radiation therapy, radiotherapy? So postoperatively, to prevent local recurrence in patients with involved or close margin, when the close margin is less than 5 millimeter, there is more chance of local recurrences, usually within 2 years. So postoperatively, to prevent local recurrence, radiotherapy can be given. Then as first therapy for patients with small primary tumor, particularly clitoral or periclitoral lesions in young and middle-aged women due to significant psychological consequences. Because if the site of tumor, the lesion is present in the clitoral or preclitoral region, then the operation, especially in young and middle-aged women, the operation like radical complete vulvectomy is very extensive and very difficult surgery, and the psychosexual and the deformed organ will be done. So to prevent that, if the lesion is very small, primarily small, then radiotherapy can be given as primary mode of therapy. Then what is the place of superficial inguinal lymphadenectomy? Only with low risk for lymph node metastasis, and when there is tumor confined to labia majora and negative superficial nodes on frozen section. When superficial nodes are negative on frozen section biopsy, then superficial inguinal lymph nodes can be done. Otherwise, radiotherapy can be given also. Then local advanced tumor may be treated with radiation plus chemo sensitizer, different like 6-platinum and other are there as that can be used. Then positive nodal status, according to the nodal status, how many nodes are positive, accordingly the management varies. When 1 or 2 microscopic nodes less than 5 millimeter, there it can be observed, there no need of removal. When 3 or more lymph nodes are more than 5 millimeter size of lymph nodes, then post op radiation is required. Then usually there is stage 1A, there is no involvement of the lymph nodes because the lesion is less than 2 centimeter and the stromal invasion is less than 1 mm. So usually there is lymph node involvement is not there, so there is no need of lymphadenectomy. But in stage 1B, when there is stromal invasion is more than 1 millimeter, then there is chance of involvement of the ipsilateral inguinal lymph nodes involvement. So there is ipsilateral inguinal lymphadenectomy should be done. Removal of the inguinal lymph nodes of the same site. Then in stage 2 lesion, depending upon the location, the radical vulvectomy and bilateral inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy is the ideal choice. But if there are more than 2 lymph nodes positive and the patients will get postoperative whole pelvic irradiation, then again postoperative pelvic irradiation. So stage 2 means radical vulvectomy with bilateral inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy. In stage 1B also, radical vulvectomy with bilateral inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy. But in stage 1A, there is radical excision is sufficient. Then stage 3 tumors, again, postoperative radiotherapy can be given if the surgery can be done, if the case is operable. So radical excision is done and instead of bilateral inguinofemoral lymphadenectomy, postoperative radiotherapy is ideal choice. Then what are the causes of death? Uremia is the most commonest cause due to ureteric obstruction, which is again due to enlarged common iliac and parietic nodes, lymph nodes. Then other cause is rupture of femoral vessels by the overlying involved inguinal lymph glands. Then another cause of death is sepsis. So there are 3 main causes are uremia and rupture of femoral vessels and sepsis. Then what is the prognosis? Again, prognosis depends upon the different factors. The most important is lymph node involvement. And usually the 5-year survival rate for vulvar cancer average is 70% for all operable cases. And what are the factors upon which prognosis depends? Number one is lymph node involvement, which is the most prognostic factor. So metastatic involvement of groin nodes, inguinal nodes, decreases the 5-year survival rate to below 50% as opposed to the 90% when lymph nodes are not involved. So when there is negative lymph nodes, inguinal lymph nodes, then the 5-year survival rate is 90%. But when it is positive, again it is decreased to 50%. But once pelvic nodes are involved, the 5-year survival rate is even less than 20% or 15%. So it is the most important prognostic factor. Then number of groin nodes involved, it depends upon the number of nodes involved. Microscopical involvement of node, regardless of stage, has a good prognosis. If there is no macroscopical involvement, only microscopic involvement is there, so it has good prognosis. then two or more positive nodes have worse prognosis. Then acute stage, then in fiber subaggregate decreases with the advancing stage from more than 90% in stage one. It's a stage 1A, it is about 100% normal or more than 90%, but in stage 4, it is decreased to 10%. So as the stage advances, the survival rate also decreases. Then another factor is differentiation. A well differentiated tumor has a better prognosis than poor differentiation. Then depth of invasion. Invasion of 1 millimeter, usually when the invasion, stromal invasion is of 1 millimeter or less than 1 millimeter, there is no risk of nodal involvement or metastasis. But when the invasion of 1 to 3 millimeter, there is chance of metastasis in case of in 6 to 8%. Then invasion of 5 millimeter metastasis, when there is present, then there is 22 to 37% incidence of malignancy there. Then another factor is surgical margin. It should be wide surgical margin, pre-cancer margin should be removed. So the surgical excision margin of more than 1 centimeter is in all diameters results in a low local recurrence. So at least 1 centimeter, more than 1 centimeter, the ideal pre-margin surgical pre of cancer. So this is the fiber survival rate in stage 1, 90%, and stage 2, 76%, and stage 3, 51%, and stage 4, 18%. So how it is decreased in stage 1 to stage 4, about five times less in stage 4. Then about recurrence, usually after 6 months of primary treatment, when there is, of course, recurrence of the lesion, then there may be local recurrence or the distal or metastatic. The in local recurrence, re-excision or radiation, and it needs to be given, and it has good prognostic value if not in original site of tumor. If the recurrence lesion is not in original site of tumor, then it is good prognosis. Then poor prognosis if in original site. If the recurrence lesion is in original site, then the prognosis is poor. Then there may be distal or metastatic recurrence lesion. It is very poor prognosis, but chemotherapy can be given, and like cisplatin, mitomycin C, bleomycin, 5-FU, methotrexate, cyclophosphamide can be given. So recurrent vulval cancer correlates most closely with the number of positive groin nodes. If positive lymph nodes less than 3, that is microscopically involved, the low incidence of recurrence at any site, there is low chance of recurrence. But if the positive lymph nodes are 3 or more, there is high incidence of local, regional, and systemic recurrence. So this is on the whole, this is the treatment protocol of the cancer vulva. So if there is we have already discussed. So nowadays, it is found that pelvic node radiation is better than pelvic node dissection. Pelvic node radiation, instead of pelvic node dissection, pelvic node radiation can be given, because pelvic node dissection is very extensive surgery with the high morbidity and mortality. So pelvic node radiation can be given instead of pelvic node dissection. The survival rate of 2 years in pelvic node dissection is 55%, whereas the survival rate of 2 years is 70% in case of pelvic node irradiation. So nowadays, instead of pelvic node dissection, pelvic node irradiation is advised. So many well-selected patients, wide excision with 2 cm margin, with or without node selection, may suffice. Because though the radical vulvectomy is the treatment of choice, but as the patients are more younger, so you should think about radical vulvectomy, and instead of radical vulvectomy, wide excision of the lesion with 2 cm margin, wide margin, free margin can be alternative. Then modified radical vulvectomy with bilateral groin node dissection will give equally good results in the majority of cases. Pelvic lymphectomy should be abandoned except in a minority of select cases, because the alternative is post op radiation. Radiation can be given. And radiotherapy should be given to the groins and pelvic postoperatively only if more than one groin node is positive. So any patient with a persistent itching or vulvar lesion not response to simple treatment, you should take multiple biopsies. This way, and age group, the most important is now age group, psychology of the patient, and the appearance of the vulva should be taken into consideration, as this will change the plan of management. So now, as there is excision of the skin, so there is role of plastic surgery in future, so it has a great role also. So usually no routine pelvic lymphectomy is usually done, instead radiotherapy is ideal. So next is melanoma, another vulval cancer, that is 5%, and it is the second most common vulval malignancy, and predominantly in postmenopausal white women, and most commonly on the labia minora and clitoris. So this is different types of melanomas, intraepithelial or into papillary dermis, filling dermal papillae, and into reticular dermis, and into subcutaneous type, and according to the depth of invasion. So what are symptoms of melanoma? There may be asymptomatic, and usually there may be pigmental lesion or itching or bleeding or groin mass. Then histologically, there are 3 types: superficial spreading melanoma, lentigo maligna melanoma, and nodular melanoma, which is most aggressive. So treatment is less than 1 mm invasion, radical local excision alone will suffice. Otherwise, if the invasion is equal or more than 1 mm, in block resection of the primary tumor and groin nodes. And alternatively, chemotherapy and immunotherapy, in these cases, it has less role. Prognosis, they are poor, and mean 5-year survival rate is 21.7 to 54%. Next is Bartholin gland carcinoma. It is also a rare cancer vulva, about 5% of vulval malignancies, and it is diagnosed according to the Hohmann's criteria. What is that? If the tumor is in the correct anatomic position, which is the Bartholin gland's position, posterolateral position, so it should be, the lesion should be in the correct anatomic position. The tumor is located deep in the labio majora, and the overlying skin is intact, and there is some recognizable normal gland must be present. For treatment, again, radical vulvectomy with bilateral groin and pelvic node dissection is the ideal treatment, or followed by the preoperative radiation. Other adenocarcinomas are adenosquamous carcinoma, and here also treatment is radical vulvectomy. Then basal cell carcinoma, it is rare, about 2% of vulva carcinoma, and most lesions are smaller than 2 cm in diameter and usually situated on the anterior labia majora. And here also the treatment is radical local excision. Then other rare vulval cancer is varicose carcinoma. It is a variant of squamous cell carcinoma and it is more common in postmenopausal women, and it is slowly growing but locally destructive lesions. And here also radical local excision is the basic treatment. And if the nodes are positive, radical vulvectomy and bilateral inguinofemoral lymphectomy is ideal treatment. And it also, here radiation therapy is contraindicated because it may induce anaplastic transformation with subsequent regional and distant metastasis. So then again, vulval sarcoma, it is also rare. 1% of vulva malignancy. So different types of sarcomas are there. Leiomyosarcoma, sarcoma, angiosarcoma, neurofibrosarcoma, liposarcoma, rare. And so next is secondary metastatic vulval tumors. That is 8% of vulval tumors are metastatic. The most common primary site is cervix and followed by endometrium, kidney and urethra, and then from other sites also vagina and choriocarcinoma, ovarian tumor, breasts. Thank you. Any doubt you can ask? So cancer of vulva is though rare, but it is the fourth commonest female genital tract cancer. First is cancer cervix, then ovarian tumor, then endometric cancer, then comes cancer vulva. So nowadays, it is more common due to STI, sexual transmitted infections, is more common in the young people. So now the treatment is modified. The treatment of choice of cancer cervix, cancer vulva is radical vulvectomy with bilateral inguinofemoral lymphectomy. But each case should be individualized, and accordingly the management varies. And nowadays more conservative surgery is being applied because the success rate of conservative surgery is almost equal to that of the radical vulvectomy, radical surgery, which was done previously. Okay, thank you.
Finished. Now you come, please. How do you know question?